Hey everyone, in this video I'm going to try and value Qualcomm. I'm going to look at their balance sheet, their income statement, check out their profitability and their dividends, and ultimately use an intrinsic valuation model to try and come up with a fair value for their company. If you're new to the channel, my name is Dan. I do a lot of investing and stock analysis videos on this channel, so hit that subscribe button if you're into that kind of thing. Alright, let's jump into it. Alright, so Qualcomm is a semiconductor. The way they make their money is really in three segments here. Number one, QCT. This is their integrated circuits and software systems based on 5G technologies. This stuff goes into computers, tablets, phones, modems, just about anything you could think of. The second largest segment is this QTL. It's kind of the same thing, really. It's just they license their intellectual property for other people to use. And that tiny little segment in green there, which accounts for less than 1% of their revenues, QSI, those are things that really haven't taken off yet, but it's things like artificial intelligence, automotive, and digital healthcare. One thing I find very interesting is that even though it's a US-based company listed here in the US, really all their sales are from overseas. You got 59% of their revenues coming from China, including Hong Kong, 13% from South Korea, 4% from Ireland, 19% from other countries combined, and the US is just 5%. So all else equal, I really like to see this. I am concerned about a weakening US dollar, and I'd like to have a company like this in my portfolio to help diversify away some of that currency risk. Okay, so let's do a vertical analysis where we take a bunch of income statements and divide every number by total revenues in that income statement. One thing I notice is gross profit as a percentage of revenues is pretty darn consistent, around 60%. That's pretty common for semiconductor industry, very high gross margins. Operating margins are also pretty decent, coming in at about 26.5% most recently. And here you've got the net income margin there. We had a bad year in 2018, but otherwise looks to be a pretty consistent, roughly 22% net income margin there. I also noticed that they're spending quite a bit on R&D. R&D expense as a percentage of revenues here is pretty darn high, and it's not really going down. That's both good and bad. I don't like to see such a large expense every year, but it does ensure they're going to stay competitive in their innovation. All right, so here is Qualcomm's balance sheet. They have decently high leverage there, 82.9% liabilities to assets ratio. That's a little high. They don't have any, you know, short-term liquidity issues though. You can see a very respectable current ratio of over 2. Which means their current assets cover their current liabilities more than 2 times over. Quick ratio also 1.84, very nice. Interest coverage ratio a little lower than I'd like to see, but not really in the danger zone there. They can cover their interest expense over 10 times with their profits. What's interesting is that even though they have a higher liabilities to assets ratio, 31.5% of all their assets are just plain cash, so they can really pay down that debt whenever they feel like it, and that's something to note. They're not too long-term asset intensive, with just 48% of their assets being long-term. Okay, so here is a DuPont analysis. If you don't know what this is and you want to learn about it, check out my video in the description below. But all I'm really doing is dissecting return on equity into its three parts there. And I'm doing it for about 5 years worth of data. I really hate to use just 1 year. It can be really misleading. As you can see here in 2018, we had that lost year. Or 2019, I don't really know what the hell happened. You got over 500% ROE. So it's good to use about 5 years and get a better picture. But, you know, even using 5 years, it's a little bumpy, but pretty darn respectable return on equity. Now, how is that, you know, created? Well, net income margin is pretty regular. Besides the last year, you're looking at a net income margin of a little over 20% on average. asset turnover is, you know, not very good here, and I like to see they've increased it. So if they keep increasing it, I like to see that. That tells us, for example, in 2020, for every dollar of assets, we were able to generate 71 cents in sales. Pretty good. And finally, leverage contributes to return on equity, and we have a lot of leverage in this company, 6.71. So overall, I like the look of the company's business based on this DuPont analysis. The company does pay a dividend, but it's a pretty low yield at 1.6%. They've really had a bumpy history recently, so they don't have any kind of history of dividend growth. If you look at the 5-year average growth rate, though, you're looking at 6.68%, which is decent. And the payout ratio is a little bit shy of 37%, leaving them a lot of room to increase the dividend or buy more shares back. So the company does have a history of buybacks. You can see they were actually net issuers of shares in 2016 and 2017. When you look at the red bars there. But on a per share basis, they really spend as much or more on share buybacks as they do on dividends. And you can see here in 2020, when pretty much everybody's stock price tanked, they went all out and spent an average of $9.25 per share on share buybacks. So they got a very good deal on those shares, and that's really going to help them as they go forward to be able to raise that dividend. Alright guys, so at this point in the video, I'm going to use an intrinsic valuation model to come up with a fair value for Qualcomm stock. I'm going to use the free cash flow to equity model. To make the model work, I need to estimate what is Qualcomm's free cash flows for the next 10 years. I'm then going to discount those back to present value, add them all up, add the cash on the balance sheet, and then add a terminal value. Because after all, the company's not worth nothing after 10 years. At that point, we're going to have some kind of terminal value. I'm going to discount the terminal value back to present value, add it all together, and come up with a fair value. So the first thing I need to do when estimating these free cash flows is figure out what are the revenues going to look like for the next 10 years. Let's have a look at analyst forecasts. All right, guys, so their forecasts are a little interesting. There is expected to be a pretty huge increase in revenues in 2021. That is likely attributable to their acquisition of Nuvia. So I believe their revenues most recently were $23 billion. They're going to go all the way up to $30 billion. But after that, notice that analysts are only expecting, you know, close to an 8% increase in revenues for 2022, and then down to a 1% increase for the year after that. So I got to consider these numbers as I forecast their revenues. All right, so here is kind of a picture of where I see the company's revenues and their free cash flows going over the next decade. So first thing I gotta do is forecast that revenue growth, and that gives me the revenues. So what I've done is I've bumped them up to about $30 billion in revenues next year. Then we have a 7.7% increase, just as the analyst forecast for the following year. After those 2 years is really anyone's guess for a few reasons. I mean, number one, because it's so far in the future. And number two, because you don't really have any analyst forecast after 2 years. I noticed there are about 4 analysts forecasting for year 3 and just 1 person for the year after that. So not too reliable, you know, one person's opinion. What I've done is tried to put a fairly modest growth path, say 7%, then 6% for a couple years, then down to 5% and then 4%. And after 10 years, of course, we assume a 2% growth rate thereafter. For net income margin, that is the other factor I got to figure out. Right now, they tend to have a margins of about 22%. And so what I've done is added a percent every year, topping out 32% there. That is more in line with their industry. And so we're going to assume they can approach that as they grow in size, they gain economies of scale. We are going to revisit that assumption, though, because it is a little generous. So, okay, once you know revenues and you know margins, that gives you your net income. So we got that far. One final step, how much money do they have to reinvest back into the company? I've given them, honestly, pretty low reinvestment rates, a little bit high at first because they have that tremendous growth going on in that 1 year. So I put 50% reinvestment rate, then 30, then down to 10. The rates are a little bit lower than they would be for a comparable firm. The reason being that much of their investments are really R&D, which is just an expense. They don't really have to buy a lot of factories and equipment and so forth. So that's the reason for that low rate. That gives us a stream of free cash flows to equity. Let's discount them back and see what the fair value is. Okay, so here is the value, guys. You got your free cash flows to equity that we calculated there. I discounted them back to present value using a 7% discount rate, which I think is fair. And that gives us a total firm value here. You got the cash on hand, the cash flows for the next 10 years. You got the terminal value. You add it all up. It's about a $215 billion company, which would be about $190.79 per share. Let's revisit this spreadsheet here. I think some of these assumptions are a little generous. So net income margin, let's say that it does not increase by as much. We're gonna slow that process down there. Let's just have it increase a little bit. Kind of top out at 25%. It's very possible, guys. It's a very competitive industry, so let's just use that assumption there for net income margin and see where that leads us. All right, guys, so with that little more pessimistic assumption about our margins for Qualcomm, we're going to end up with a fair value of $155.59 per share, making it not such a great deal given the current share price of $162. Okay, guys, so here are my final thoughts on Qualcomm. Well, I think they have a decent balance sheet. They have a pretty good profitability. I mean, look at the DuPont analysis. I love that they're international. You got sales everywhere, diversifying your currency risk. And their biggest market is China, followed by South Korea. These are both growing markets, and I really like to see that. So I really want to add them to my portfolio, but honestly, I really just can't quite do it at the current price. When I look at the model, my best estimates, which again are a little fuzzy because we're not sure how the acquisition with Nuvia is going to work out, but given my best estimates, it could be close to fair value or it could be undervalued, but I don't see a big enough margin of safety for me to want to jump in at this point. So for me, I'm going to wait. I'm going to hopefully it drops down to a price, maybe 150. I would jump all over it. If it never goes down that far, I can live with that. But I'm a little more conservative. That's just my style. That's what I'm going to do. Let me know what you guys are going to do in the comments below. Make sure to hit that like button if you haven't already. Thank you for watching.